right. Good morning. Morning, Living Hope Church family and friends that are scattered around Chatfield City Park. You may have heard the announcement in our email last Thursday that we are in the Chatfield City Park as long as possible, weather permitting. So we're just wondering that maybe mid-October, how cool you might get. The parkas might come on early November. No, God's going to provide what we need each step of the way, but we're going to be here, and we're going to communicate with you Saturday morning. If the weather is not favorable, then we'll be meeting at the Potter Auditorium, just a half a block over. There's a new regulation that they have, is that every event that's happening in that building will have required masks, so bring your masks with when we're for sure in the auditorium. And then even following the service, we'd love for people to mingle, but as you know, some of our folks that are older or have more conditions, if they have a mask on and you have a mask and you want to talk with them, probably best for you to just put your mask on. It's not that big of a deal. But again, we're thankful that we can be outside. And again, smile, that's our connection as we make connections each Sunday. Just so thankful that we can be together as the body of Christ. If you pull out your bulletins, there's just a couple things I want to highlight as well. The Discover Living Hope membership class, we are going to have one today, and there was only one family that signed up, so we're going to push that off to do the one-shot session on Sunday, August 2nd. We'll have a 2.5 or 3 hour class that will cover Discover Living Hope, and that's really a class that talks about who we are and where we're going, and also a way of saying, hey, I'm going to embrace this church and the mission, and hopefully some of you will become members, and we'll be able to keep carrying on in a way that impacts this great Chosen Valley area. You'll also notice that there's three options. You can sign up today, Sunday, Tuesday, or Saturday, and if none of those works, just write on there. We're going to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to go through this class and have an opportunity to become a member if you'd like. And the greatest membership that you can have is in the membership of God's family. That trumps everything. And that's what we call for at Living Hope Church, that you are a believer in Jesus Christ. You'll see next week we're going to have a picnic in a park, and it's been so hot we decided to switch that. So we have rented the Chatfield pool. All you need to do is bring your swimsuit, wear your swimsuit and a towel, bring a friend, bring a lawn chair. They don't have any kind of chairs out there. And come and swim. Or come and enjoy the family of God in that pool area. And use this opportunity to invite a friend or a neighbor that normally doesn't come to church. Well, they can come to a pool party and hopefully get to know some more people in the family of God. That's next Sunday, 5 to 7. Dad's camping trip. You can also show your response on the response card that you'd like to come. We'd love all of our dads to look at coming for at least a day and for many of you to stay overnight. We have it just one night because that's about all that dads can handle with their kids alone without their lovely wives. That is the end of this month, the 31st. Anyway, why don't you stand with me and we're going to recite our fighter verse this month. Our fighter verse is a verse that we want you to memorize, take to heart, and it really fits into our theme, we are the church. So let's read this out loud together wherever we're at. Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. God has put all things under the authority of Christ and made him head over the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. We're going to talk more about that this morning, but he is putting everything under the authority of Christ, and we're under his authority. Let's bow our heads and pray. God, thank you for such a beautiful morning, a break from the intense heat yesterday. Thank you for this beautiful setting in this park where we have shade trees. And even more than that, we have the body of Christ, young and old, together. God, I thank you for our worship team that's coming to use their gifts this morning from Rochester and their care for this little church and praying that this little church will multiply into other little churches around the southeastern Minnesota. God, bless them as they lead us in worship. As you are the audience, not us, you. God, we sing to you. We are reminded of you and how big and powerful and how personal you are. God, each one of us, no doubt, needs to be filled up this morning. Fill us up with your Holy Spirit. For us to be able to keep doing the work that you've called us to do, we need the power of the Holy Spirit alive and well, and us surrendering and following you, God. So we commit the service to you, the songs to you, the scriptures that we read, the message that we hear. We commit it to you, God. And all of God's people said, amen. You'll find the music words on the inside of your bulletin. Join in worship.
Good morning. Psalm 63, 1 through 5 says, oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I've looked upon you in sanctuary, beholding your power and glory, because your steadfast love is better than life. My lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live in your name. I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied. My mouth will praise you with joyful lips. Let's sing out in praise for all that God does for us.
Open up the heavens, we wanna see you.
that our prayer this morning? We sing it, but do we sing it as a prayer from our heart? I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. Young and old, we need that firm foundation because our world has been shaking more than normal. It's always been shaking from the beginning because of sin, but it's just greater things that are being displayed in front of us that have caused things to bring about fear and anxiety, and we can give those things over to God as the people of God, to one who can hold it and care for us. Let me see your hands this morning if you feel God's taking care of you. Let me see your hands. I hope he's taking care of you. You need to share that caring with other people because they're feeling all alone. I'm going to ask you to sit right now, and we're going to take just a moment to pray, and I have my volunteer, John. He's going to put that mic near your mouth. You don't have to touch it. He's not going to get close to you, but can I have 2-3 prayer requests right now? Raise your hand. He's going to run to you carefully. A couple prayer requests. How can we pray for the body of Christ? I get prayer requests given to me, but even this morning, let's take a moment. How can we be praying for you? Anyone? Okay, right over here.
We can pray for the city of Chatfield. It's very divided about Western Days and just the whole, you know, that we are just pray for our own city right now. It's very important.
Yeah, great request. We're in the city park, and we can pray for unity for our city council and for this whole handling of the COVID-19 issue is causing challenges for churches, for communities, for governments. We need God's wisdom. Yeah.
We have a friend who's probably a Muslim who just told me this morning his dad is dying, and he's concerned about the future, so we're hoping to get together with him and share the gospel with him.
Oh, amen. Amen. No matter what kind of position we're in, if we're without Christ, we need him. And these are opportunities when somebody is reaching out or asking for prayer or in a time of struggle, which is all over the place. We have the answer. Thanks for sharing that message. And we'll pray that the gospel will penetrate into this person's heart. What's their first name? Or the family name?
His name is Barack.
Barack? Okay. Any other prayer request? Back here, Johanna. Johanna's part of our young adult group. We can pray for our young adults because they meet on Friday nights, and there's a good half a dozen to 10 of them that come. And if you're in that category, come join us as we study God's word and remind ourselves who we are in Christ.
Our family friend, Carolyn, went to the hospital yesterday. She's struggling with inoperable cancer in her liver, and she's not doing good. They say she's probably only has 2 months to live. So just pray for their family.
Mm. Does that family know the Lord? So
yes,
it's not a need for sharing the gospel, but a need for them to remind themselves of God's love and comfort and strength in the midst of being in a tough spot. A tough spot. Thankful again for our medical personnel that help in so many different ways on a regular basis. Any last prayer requests that you'd like to share publicly this morning? Okay, way in the back. Run, John, carefully. I don't know, I thought it'd be kind of fun to get the... You want to pan, Mr. John? You should pan this group.
I just pray that that the spirit of fear will leave, especially the body of believers, so that we can shine in the darkness for everybody around.
Amen. To walk in faith, way more than fear. Let's bow our heads and let's pray together. God, thank you. Thank you that you are here in this place. You're really here wherever we go as believers in Jesus Christ. You reside within us in the power of the Holy Spirit. God, thank you for that gift. Help us to be reminded in the morning that it is a gift to be surrendered to follow, to honor. Again, I pray that Living Hope Church would not just grow in numbers, we grow in love for you, God. spiritual growth. And from that, families will be impacted, marriages will be restored, cities will be transformed. God, you will be ultimately glorified. That's what it's all about, for us to be used each day to bring glory to you. And we do that by sharing the gospel. So I pray for the Grabow family as they share with Barack. And hopefully many others of us, even this week, share with someone the gospel that Jesus, you came to this earth, this broken earth, and you gave your life so that we might have life. God, I pray that Barack would, there would be at least a seed planted today. And that seed would grow, and one day he'd realize, I'm blind and I want to see. And you'd give him that sight, God, a relationship with you, a life-changing Savior. Father, I pray for Johanna and her friends that are struggling with cancer, and we have other people that are in the hospital or struggling with physical illnesses. Lord, we lift them to you as the great physician. God, would you cover their needs, oh God? Comfort them. When it's your will, of course, we pray that you'd heal them. You'd heal them, God, of the things that they're struggling with, and that would place your trust in you. Thank you again for medicines and doctors and things like that, but God, we know that overall you are in control. And we commit that to you, Jesus, those people that are in need, physical need. We also pray for those that are in emotional need, that are struck with fear and anxiety. God, would they realize we have been given faith. You even believe in us to take a step of faith. God, help us to have a greater amount of faith moving forward, believing that you've got us, that we can move forward with clarity, being precautious about our own physical needs, but ultimately trusting you in it all. And on that note, I pray for the city of Chatfield, practically, just like right when we're meeting in this public place that we're thankful to be at. We pray for wisdom for the city council as they think about this upcoming event. We give them wisdom on having it or not. God, we thank you for the wisdom you keep giving the leadership team from you, that we're meeting here as long as we can, and we have the Potter Auditorium to meet in as well, and we pray that you keep opening the doors because we need you too, God. We're desperate for you to keep leading the way, and we believe that you will. Again, thank you for the body of Christ, that we're not here alone in this journey. We thank you that you're in charge, Lord. Not only be in charge of this church, be in charge of our individual lives. So again, we commit ourselves to you this day. Thank you for prayer, that we can lift up any request to you. Thank you for prayer. And as we continue our time in worship, to be reminded of what that communication with you is about, we just say thank you, Jesus, for listening to us and answering prayers according to your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The name of Jesus is a refuge, a shelter from the storm, a help to those who call. The name of Jesus is a fortress, a saving place to run, a hope unshakable when we fall. You are the Savior when we call. You are the answer. There is power in your name. There is power in your name. In the name of Jesus, there is life and healing. Chains are broken in your name.
you. Thank you for sharing your gifts and coming on over, and I hope that we get to see you when we can. When we can. I've known Greg and Karen for a while. I was a part of their parents' lives and able to be a part of their celebration of life services, so they're a beautiful family, and we're in the family of God together. I forgot to mention that we don't pass an offering plate anymore, but we have our offering box over there, and you'll also notice that we have given you an update on our finances that you'll find in the back of the bulletin, and our giving is over our expenses, so we're thankful for God's provision, and that's what he's doing. He's providing for us through you and for his glory. For those that may not know me, I'm Paul Langmaid. I'm the only pastor here at Living Hope Community Church, but really we have many other leaders and servants here, and I'm so thankful I'm not alone in this role. We're here together. We've been in a series called We Are the Church. This last month, we talked about the ministry of the church, which is reconciliation, the first Sunday in July. Reconciliation, that each one of us have been given that role to reach out to somebody else that is in this broken world that needs to be reconciled to God. And why reconciled? Because sin removes us from a holy God, and it's only Jesus who can reconcile us from being in a sinful state to reaching a holy God. And he did that by taking the sins of the world upon himself. The ministry of reconciliation is us living out as ambassadors, representing him, sharing the gospel. So the grab owls this afternoon or this week are going to be offering that ministry of reconciliation. But every one of us have been called to that role, not just pastors or certain leaders in their church. Every single one of us. Do I see a family having a blanket on them this morning? A blanket? Oh, my. By the way, if you don't know, I have ADD. So I love being out in the park here and watching birds fly, and some of you have it as well. You're probably not listening to me. But the second point is we talked about not just the ministry of the church of reconciliation. We talked about the metaphor of the church, which is the bride of Christ. That's what we're called. That's the picture, the bride of Christ. Last week, we talked about what it's like to be at a wedding ceremony. And the beauty of watching that bride come in. And then to watch that groom watch the bride. And that exchange of love and affection is beautiful. Jesus is that groom. And we are called that bride. And the one he loves us so much. That of course he gave his life to die for us. And we are called as men to love our wives in such a way. That Christ loved the church. And he gave himself for the church. Men, we are to give our lives to our wives, to love them, to care for them, as Christ has done for us as the church. The bride of Christ, I hope you're reminded of how much you are loved by an almighty, wonderful, amazing God. He calls us his bride, and that is precious. If you missed that message, you can catch it online and be reminded of who you are. Today, we're talking about the membership of church. The members of the church. What is it? The body of Christ. You and I making up the body. And you can find, I'm going to ask you at this time to open up your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Some of the text is also found in your bulletin, in the back of the bulletin. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Here we have the Apostle Paul speaking to the church in Corinth, and we know this church was in this city full of lots of idols, lots of sinful things, not unlike the world that we live in. And he's giving these people some encouragement, because we live in a divided world. We talked about that. We prayed about that this morning. We need some encouragement to not just live in division, but live in unity, especially as the body of Christ. Why don't you stand for the reading of God's word here? Let's read this out loud together. I'll be reading from the English Standard Version. Even you at home, stand up. You can get off your couch, really. Stand up. Now, we do this standing for honor of God, and sometimes just to alert ourselves to how important God's word is. Okay? For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we are all baptized in one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of this one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. Or if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. Verse 17, if the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members of the body, each of them as he chose. Verse 19, if all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and on those parts of the body that we think less honorable, we bestow the greater honor, and on our unpresentable parts are treated with great modesty, which are more presentable parts that do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there would be no division in the body, that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer. What's that next word? Together. If one member is honored, all rejoice. What? Together. Together. God, we just pray that this word would sink into our hearts, our head and our hearts, through our eyes and our ears, to our hearts, to action. Speak, Lord, to the power of your Holy Spirit this morning, or this afternoon, or this evening, whenever we're watching or participating. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Jesus' name. If you look again at 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 13 in your Bibles or your Bible apps, again, how many times do you read the word one? How many times do you read the word one? A little work right here. How many times? One time? Two times? How many times do you see the word one in verses 12 and 13? Can't hear you. I actually have my hearing aids in too. Five times? Is that what it is? What do we have? We have five times. Obviously trying to make a point here that we are one. We're in to be in unity. Even though, look at the body of believers even here this morning, there's unity but also diversity. What does that show us? There's a tension there. There's unity in the body of Christ, but also there's diversity, and yet that's a healthy tension, that together we're to work as one, but yet we're also very different in the way that God has gifted us, wired us, and wants to use us. We are to be together as one. There's a healthy tension going on. This is one of many, many healthy tensions in the Bible. Again, Paul is clearly trying to make the point that we are one body, even though we are many members. And we see this throughout this passage. He makes his comparison between the church and the human body. But before I read about that more, let me tell you about a little parable. This parable is told about a group of animals deciding to improve the general welfare of their lives by starting a school. So a bunch of animals starting a school. We have a veterinarian thinking, what is he talking about? Animals don't start a school. Well, just imagine this. The curriculum included swimming, running, climbing, and flying. The duck, obviously an excellent swimmer, was deficient in other areas, so he majored in climbing, running, and flying, much, though, to the detriment of his swimming. The rabbit, the superior runner, was forced to spend so much of his other time in the classrooms that he soon lost much of his important speed because he was focusing on the other things. The squirrel, who had been rated A as a climber, he dropped to a C because his instructor had him teach him hours and hours how to swim and fly. And then the eagle was disciplined for soaring through the treetops when he had been told to learn how to climb, even though flying was most natural to him. You know, this parable really circulated for years in different educational circles as a reminder that people are different. Every one of us, again, are different. There's that diversity in the body of Christ, even a part of Living Hope right here. But everyone, again, is not the same. That's the genius and the glory as well as the frustration of being a human being. Every one of us made in a unique way, beautiful, special, and made by God for a purpose. Next week, we'll be wrapping up our series, What is a Church? Or actually, the following week, but we have been made for a mission. And what's that mission? To make disciples, but we even do that in a unique way for the glory of God because he has created us in such a way to do this for him, but in different ways. Some of us go through our life banging our heads on the wall, trying to break through success in areas in which we're simply not gifted. Work in your gifted areas. Others of us exploit our gifts to those and neglect those who need us. We just brag about maybe the things that we're doing. Think about that illustration this morning. Different animals try and do different things, but not operating out of the way that God has gifted them. God uses that, not that example in this passage. He uses example of a human body. He has a picture right here in this human body. It's one organism, one person, one being, one life. Yet it has different parts to it. What's the part we see right here? Look at the phrase in verse 12. So it is with Christ. So it is with Christ and Christ's body. Our human bodies have many parts, yet we're still one body. This morning, I want us to begin with just three simple action statements. We even talked about this last year when we were just beginning our church. The number one is, understand your position in the body of Christ. What's our position right here? This position right here is God. He's the head of the church. And here's us. We're the body. That's not a bad circle. In this right here is God. He's the head of the church. He's put Jesus in charge. Not us. Sometimes we get confused and we put Jesus below us. But no, God says, I'm the head of the church. Whether you believe it or not, I'm the head of the church. And sometimes churches have mixed that up, thinking that, oh, no, wait a minute, the pastor's the head of the church or the elders of the church are the head of the church. No, all those things are under God's headship. Number one thing I want us to remember this morning, even as we move along as part of Living Hope Community Church, is that Jesus is the head. How do we know this? Read the first passage on the back of your bulletin, Colossians 1:18. Colossians 1:18, it says, and he, Jesus, is the head of the body. He is the beginning, the firstborn of the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. Preeminent. What's preeminent? That's a word we don't use too often. Preeminent means surpassing all others, distinguished in some way. This morning, what's distinguished to me is someone cuddled in a blanket. That's distinguished. You are preeminent this morning. Nothing wrong with that. Hopefully we're not preeminent in the sins that we do or the wrong things that we fall into, but that God is surpassing everything. He's preeminent in our life. He's over all, above all. What is going on? What does the city of Chatfield, the council, the leadership need over all them? They need to be following Jesus. What would God say in this situation? What does God's word say in this situation? There is no one like our God. We sing about that. Hopefully we believe that and live that. So you and I and our position in Christ is to be under him. But also there's another picture here, to be a part of God's family. We see that in verse 13. Read with me. For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slaves or free. We're all made to drink of this one Spirit. Simply saying that when you and I become a Christian, we have the Holy Spirit that comes and resides within us. That Spirit baptism. There's no greater honor or privilege that we have as children of God than to have the Spirit of Christ within us. And notice this phrase, and you have all been made to drink into one spirit. Again, a little confusing, but it simply means, again, that the Holy Spirit completely fills our innermost beings, that we all have the same possibility to be used by God in ministering to others. When you give your life to Christ, when you surrender your life to Christ and say, God, I need you. I need your forgiveness. I need your ability to walk another step in the right direction. Come into my life. When you invite him in, that Holy Spirit fills you and anyone else in the same capacity. I don't have more of the Holy Spirit than you as believers in Jesus Christ, and you don't have more than me. But the difference is when we have that same amount of the Holy Spirit, but the difference is some of us are surrendering to the Holy Spirit in a different degree. The Holy Spirit is to be here, and sometimes we bring him here, or we bring him below us. In a sense, it's a surrender issue. It's not a filling issue. Are we surrendering to the work of God in our life? Meaning every day we say, God, use me, fill me, direct me. We have that same Holy Spirit as believers in Jesus Christ. That's the unity, right? That's the unity, even though your last name is different. Your skills are different. Your home location is different. There's so many differences among all of us here this morning, but we're united because that same Holy Spirit. United, but again, in diversity. And there's that tension to be using our gifts and abilities in a different way. These animals that we talked about that have these different skills and abilities, they need to just operate. An eagle should just fly. Some of you, I'm praying, even have been praying, that when we plant, Lord willing, maybe in Preston or Spring Valley someday, God might raise up a pastor, someone who loves the Word of God, that wants to preach. Or God will raise up other shepherds to lead a life group that shepherds a group of 8 to 10 people. Or God will raise up another worship team that will go on and serve in another nearby town. We all have these different gifts. Use those gifts that God has given you, or develop those gifts that God has given you. So where are we? We're down here. Jesus is on top, and we're down here. So here's my stick people. That's you, and that's me, and that's them, and that's them. So here we are. We're in the body of Christ under Jesus, the head, the authority, using our different gifts. And what are we supposed to be doing? We walk together, we talk together, we serve together. And ultimately, we'll find out in our mission more, or we talk about it usually each week. Together, together, what's our mission statement? Do you guys remember it? Loving God, serving others, and sharing hope. Say that again with me this morning. Loving God, serving others, sharing hope. Together, not separate. And even when we're not physically together, when we need to broadcast just online, we're still together. Why? Because that togetherness isn't just because we're physically together. No, it's the Holy Spirit that binds us together, and we want that Holy Spirit to be in the hearts of more people. So pray, share, and live in a way that shows that you're different from this world. I ask you this morning, are you part of this family? Do you have the Holy Spirit in your life? If not, I'd love to talk with you about what that means to take that next step in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Just mark that on your response card. Drop that in the offering box, and I'll follow up with you. What does this mean to follow after Jesus? That's the most important decision you can ever make. Well, not only are we understanding our position in the body of Christ under Jesus, we, number two, discover our part. What's our part? According to verse 14, every believer is part of the body. Every one of us. Every one of us, part of the body of Christ. And every part is essential to the proper functioning of the whole church. That's why I'm excited as we go through these membership classes and you share your testimonies that you're a believer in Jesus Christ. When we have that membership, people say that I'm in. It's certainly not a perfect church. But I'm in to be a part of a mission that wants to reach more and more and shine for Jesus together and then be used by the Lord? Because I have a part to play. Every one of us have that part to play together. So the body of Christ is formed by believers from all walks of life, cultures, and really with nothing else in common except the fact that they've received Jesus as their saviors. Jew, Greek, slave or free, diversified, but yet together, all together. And we need that togetherness. Let's not fall into the trap that we read in verses 15 to 18, though. Let's read this. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would make it any less of the part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would make it any less part of the body. And if the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? Or the whole body an ear, where would the sense of smell? Again, God arranged the members in the body of Christ, each of them as he chose. And again, look at verse 18. God arranged the members, which means there's no mistake where God has placed you in a position, because sometimes we think we're not needed or we fall into comparisons. I want to be more like them. I want to sing like them. I want to have that knowledge to hook up technology stuff like them. Don't fall in that comparison trap. Hopefully once a month we have somebody else up here leading and preaching, and I'm excited because many of them are better than me. It doesn't matter. That's great. There's always someone better than us. Ultimately, it's Jesus, but there's someone better than us. It just doesn't matter. We are loved by God, the bride of Christ, to be the person that he's created us to be. We want to celebrate people using their gifts, but hopefully not to say, look how good I am, but don't fall into that comparison. So as we have different roles laid out more formally in this church, but hopefully in a simpler way, let's celebrate one another and not compare. Or say, I'm useless, I can't do anything. Yes, every one of you can do something. Kevin, or I won't say more names, but some of you may not sing very well, but actually I don't even know if Kevin sings well or not, but he plays an awesome trumpet. He plays on Christmas Eve. Why just Christmas Eve? Maybe next week, play your trumpet. How appropriate out here in the park. Or next time Mark, Greg, or Karen comes, they'll work a trumpet part in there. That'd be unique. Use your gifts that God has given you, because we all have a part. So not only understand your position under Jesus, but understand that you have a part to play. I'm going to ask our children to come up right now. Come on up. Our children, come to the front. And as they come, I want to remind you again, the eye doesn't tell the hand that it doesn't need it. The head does not tell the feet to get lost, for without them there'd be no movement. What Paul is saying here is that every part of the body needs every other part to fully work out the body, the human body. We need everything a part of us to do the things that God has called us to do. Now even look at your fingers and your thumbs right now, kids. Look at them. Do you thank God for your fingers or your thumbs? Do you thank God for your feet or your toes? Everything about us is the way that God's created us for a purpose, and it's an important purpose. This morning, I'm going to ask you to stand back up, and I'm going to give you some roles, because we need some roles here this morning. It can't just be one person doing one thing. All right, who wants to be my greeter? Sunday morning greeter. All right, come here. You're my greeter. The greeter's always a flashy person. They're saying, hey, welcome to church. We love to have you here. So that's you. You're the one welcoming people to church on Sunday morning. Can you say, welcome? Welcome. Welcome. Thank you. Welcome. Okay, then we need people that will be handing out our bulletins. This is, who wants to be my bulletin hander-outer? All right. There you go. We just want to make sure you're seen. You're kind of like that usher person, and you got your bulletin in your hand. There you go. We need that part to be played. All right, what's another one? We have people that, we don't have it right now, but we have coffee people and people that like to drink water. Who wants to be my hospitality person? Who's going to be that? They don't want to do it because we don't have it right now. No hospitality. No, anyone want to be a hospitality? Look at that. See, we need more people. This is this person right here. That's just our need right here. No drinks right now. All right. Okay. Who's going to be my fun guy? Who's going to be my fun guy? Huh? The person that wanna works with children and youth. You hold that football there. We need someone that works with our children and youth, not just playing games, but teaching them the Word of God. That kind of like youth pastor kind of person. You're that person. All right. Who wants to, be our fix-it guy? Because there's things that just go wrong. All right, you can. That's not going to work around your waist. We'll just put that right here. You got your tool belt, and maybe that kind of represents somebody who puts the sound system together. And you got to still stay a little bit apart here. And all right, so who's going to be, who's going to be the pastor? Huh? Okay, Mila, yeah, you hold the Word of God. You're our pastor this morning. You're teaching the Word right here. Oh, I forgot one more thing. Who's got a dollar bill? I'd take a five, but you probably don't want that gone. Give me a dollar bill. Keep following me. No, we got one coming here. This man's just rich. He's rich not because of finances, because he's rich because he knows Jesus. Everybody say that out loud together. We are rich. We are rich because we know Jesus. All right. Does she have to give this back to you? Yes. Look at best for last. You get money. You don't want it? Okay, I'll take it. No, you just got to hold this dollar. You stand up here. You know what this gal is? She's our usher person. She's the one that counts money and things like that. So here we have a different part to play. And that's just picturing the church right here. And there's so many other roles that we have. And yet, sometimes, even in these roles, we can operate independently and sometimes not think about the other person. And all of a sudden, there's trouble because we think, well, everyone just needs to be an usher and forget the rest of you. No, we need to be together. We need to connect together. So this little rope, I'm not going to tie you up. That's probably not a good thing. But this rope, if you can grab a part of this rope, it just reminds you we're all connected. We are connected. I'm going to get a nice little picture right here because you look good. This is a picture of the body of Christ connected together in our different roles. And that's what God says. I want you to be like in the church. If you don't remember anything, remember these cute kids and what they represent. Okay, I'm going to just give a little quiz. What's this first one? What's their role? The greeter. We love our greeters. And what's your role? The usher. Yes, and what's the role? Our what? He's our football player. Youth pastor, children's worker, whatever, right here. He's our fixer, sound guy, whatever. And then right over here, our pastor, yes, or our teacher. And then finally, what's this one? Our treasurer or offering taker. Anyway, there's so many other roles that we have. Thankful that we use them. Thank you for helping out. You can just drop your things. Not you, I'd keep that. And you can have a seat. Thank them for their help. Give them a clap offering. Okay, that's good. By the way, we're waiting for someone to do hospitality right here. Oh, no, you can have it, really. You said so. Don't you love it? That's right, I'm just giving money away. We'll grow this church one way. Children are like, man, I'm coming back. I'm praying for a five. So first point. Understand our what? Our position. We are under Christ and in his family as a believer in Jesus Christ. The second role was understand or realize our part in the body of Christ. We all have a part to play. And then final challenge this morning is that we just work together. Again, we've talked about it already. We're in unity, but yet with diversity. And there's a tension. That tension is okay. Let's work together. We're going to have conflicts coming up in the future. Let's work through those. That's what a good, healthy family does, right? A good, healthy marriage, they work through conflicts. Conflicts are part of life. And they also can bring out issues of sin in our life that we can lay down and give over to the Lord. So believe me, we'll face conflicts. Let's work together in the body of Christ. So let's finish off by reading verses 25 and 26. It says, may no division in the body. Let's not have no division in the body, that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffers together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Pretty clear. We're not to have division. And yet, when you look around our world, you see a lot of division. It's sad. You think about the church in the world, there's so much division. And there really shouldn't be as much when we realize Jesus is in charge. Just, we may not like it, but that's what God's word says. We fall under his word. And then when we don't compare or fight about our roles in the church, ultimately there's more of a sense of unity and ownership and hopefully love. We're to promote unity. When we promote unity, people are going to want to be a part of that body. Unity not just in Sunday morning, but unity as we do ministry. Unity as we think about outreach. Unity in caring for one another. That's another point to care for one another. Again, when one person hurts, we hurt with that person. We love that person. We care for that person. I'm so thankful as a pastor to see people that pray for one another on the phone or send emails or cards. You're caring for one another. I encourage you to keep doing that. That's so encouraging. What's the next step? Look at the question. You may not have this one, but what gifts have God given you? We're going to talk a little bit about gifts in this class, but we're going to do another bigger class on spiritual gifts someday. But what gifts have God given you? Raise your hand right this morning if you think you have a gift that God can use. Raise your hand. Wait a minute. Okay, now I just want everyone to raise your hand. Just raise it. You have a gift. I hopefully am not the one to convince you, but you have a gift. May the Holy Spirit be the one that convinces you. Wake up. I want to use you. And if you're an eagle, I want you to fly. If you're a squirrel, I want you to climb. If you're a duck, I want you to swim. Use the gifts that God has given you. We all have different gifts. Right now, you know, in church planting, Lori and I were nervous about doing this whole thing again because a lot of times you just start to, you wear all these hats. Not only do you look dumb, you're just going to burn out. This church is not my church, it's God's church. I always love when people come to me and say, yeah, I might go to your church someday. That's not my church. It can be your church, though, under God's authority. It's your church. Again, that's this process of membership that I hope that many of you would take it seriously. And basically, being a member, you're saying, this is my church. This is my body of believers that I want to belong to. Not perfect, but I love them more than not. And I know I can love them even more when I'm a part of this body. And I'm committed to their mission. They want to multiply. When, we don't know, but we want to multiply. Why? Because we see the need of reconciliation greater and greater. And you can minister even better when you're right there in the hub of some community. Continue to pray with us as we move with God's strength in whatever direction he's calling us. That final question is, where is God calling you to serve in the body of Christ? Take that to heart. Take that to heart. And realize in this last song that we're going to sing, this is amazing grace. God has grace and patience with us to use the gifts that we have for him. Thank the Lord. Where's God going to use me? I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I hope that you want to be used by God. And thank you, many of you, that you're being used in various ways. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again that you've called us to be a part of the body of Christ. And the ultimate calling is having a relationship with you, that you're head of the church. And then, of course, head over our lives, that we've been saved and marked and sealed by the promised Holy Spirit. the presence of you in each one of us as followers of Jesus. God, thank you. Thank you for the body of Christ. As 52 years old, I love the body of Christ more and more each year. Why? Because I see people transformed by the work of the Holy Spirit to not just serve in a certain way, but to use their gifts to honor you and flourish. God, I pray that this body would flourish and those that are outside the body, so to speak, would come to know you in a personal way and join the body and then multiply the body through discipleship and evangelism. Again, anoint these your people with the power of your Holy Spirit to do just that, to use our gifts for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go with you. May he go beside you to befriend you, behind you to protect you, above you to watch over you, within you to empower you, and before you to to show you the way. Amen. God bless you this week.